so we get a better distribution of our students. When I say a better, I mean a more, what to us reflects the distribution that there ought to be. I mean, we have some situations where we have, we think, more students in honors courses than really ought to be there by the teacher's judgment and by just sort of an observation of the grades that they get. I think that holds up. And what we are trying to do is redistribute them. I think that it may mean we will have, instead of four honors, two algebra two sections, we would have two honors algebra two sections and have two more college placement sections. And that would probably be a more accurate representation of the spectrum of students in algebra two. But this year there are, I think I have them counted correctly, four of those sections. So I think I've got that right.
I think that's right.
Or there are at least three, but I thought there was a fourth. And I may have misstated it, but in any case, that the examples, even if there are three, there may be one less honor section, one more college placement section. You know, there are 52 students, I believe that's right, in Honors World SIP. It could be that, and there's a College Placement World SIP course, it's got 11 and 10. It could be that distribution might change. If, for example, there were five fewer in each of those Honors World SIP sections, 10 more in that CP section that's 10 at the moment, then you'd have sections that are about 20 throughout that course, which would be much more what we would have in mind.
I just think the parents should be aware that that's under consideration.
I think what we're trying to do is more aggressively counsel them, and I think we're also trying to look hard at our level two courses and as we define our outcomes for courses, trying to make sure that we have expectations that are sufficiently high to be challenging students in the level two courses.
We've had this discussion before, but isn't it, regardless of how challenging our level two courses are, aren't colleges still looking at the fact that if you don't take honors courses, you're never taking the most challenging course?
I think there is an interest on the part of many students to take honors courses because they're called honors courses, yes, as well.
But isn't that what the university, I mean, Loretta last year, put that same question up at some point in time during the budget hearings. That
colleges like to see honors courses on
their
transcript.
That's right.
And people like to present the best transcript they can, so they'd like to present honors courses. I think what we are trying to do, and we talked about this the other night at the curriculum night last week, what we are trying to do is say to people and then deliver that instead of when a teacher has a continuum of students in an honors course, some of whom belong there and some of whom don't, rather than pitching the instruction so that most of the students out of, say, 26 can cope with that instruction, the teacher next year is going to pitch it at the top of that continuum and run it on a faster level. And that is true not just in social studies, but I think in English and science and mathematics. And I think there's been a consistency of teachers, and I think the other night certainly there was considerable support for us to do that. The teachers want to do that as well. And I think the board has gone on record in the past saying that they would support that, if that's what they'd like to see happen. So now it remains for us to deliver on that.
The 4/10 math curriculum coordinator that's coming out of supposedly system-wide, isn't that really more to do with the high school math curriculum development? And shouldn't be that the fact?
No, I don't think that's quite correct. My understanding of the curriculum director's position in mathematics is that that's really going to focus on K-12. And Dr. Efron will teach two sections of math here, one section in middle school, and spend considerable time looking at the entire math curriculum and trying to make sure that we put this math package that we've already spent a lot of training and time on and are doing that, and that we really bring it to fruition the way we'd like to. Is that correct, Michael, or is that, I stated that?
It's very much K-12.
Were you done, Peter?
No, I have a couple more, but go ahead.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Give me a rest.
No, I was commenting because you were dealing with curriculum.
No, go ahead.
That was why, no, go ahead.
Well, minor, I have one question, which is, it must be something I'm missing, but go to page 4 on Office of the Principal. And I learn something every day. We do use them for training our, quote, natural helpers, capitalized, our peer counselors.
Right.
Who is that?
Who are our peer counselors?
Who are our natural helpers?
Our natural helpers are some 20 plus students who are student peer counselors that are available for students to talk with about various problems. They have been through a workshop in the fall, which trains them to detect problems that they might refer to somebody, or just simply to learn to be good listeners and help their peers talk about a problem. And I think that the person who can give you the best information on that is Mrs. Kerr, who is not able to be here tonight, but she is the advisor for the natural helpers. And I think that basically it is training to help kids learn to listen, and when they hear something that they really think that they should seek extra help on, can refer that to Mrs. Kerr or to a guidance counselor or to Mrs. Salt.
Good. Okay. On the library, is there any possibility of getting any community support, donations of books? Is there any, or is this, would you end up with a lot of old books if you tried that?
She would. She has already gone through the library shelves and thrown out a lot of old books. And I think that the books that you have in your library that you'd like to give to the high school, she might be very,
very valuable.
I'm sure you do. And I'm sure they may in fact be more valuable to you than to her, but I think that some of the books she needs are updated ones.
I can't remember if it was somewhere in here or somewhere else I read that a school had an encyclopedia that was so outdated that when they went to look up computers, referred them to arithmetic.
Exactly. That's right. I'm not sure that's what Mrs. Bell has in mind for updating the collection.
You can see I'm down to my really...
You're reaching the bottom of the barrel.
I hope to save all of these until everybody has gone.
That's right.
There is a... Harper Computer has a program whereby, which I think they've just introduced, at least I just heard of it, whereby if parents buy, say, 15 Macintoshes, then the school would get one for free. You have a mostly an Apple II computer lab, correct?
That's correct, but we have not bought Apple II computers in the last 2 years.
Well, you probably ought to have a Macintosh lab over time.
That's correct.
The question
we
is
are
how
not
you make
buying
it.
Any. We are not buying any more Apple II, but
yes,
we are.
I'm sure of that. But how do you get the Macintoshes in there?
We would have to start budgeting for more computers, which we have very few in the budget. And we would like to increase. The math department is requesting a Macintosh LC, which has a larger screen, a faster CPU, and also has color graphics. And some of the math programs, there's a substantial math program called Mathematica, which will do some very interesting graphing for students, and I think we need more sophisticated computers there. We need more sophisticated computers in science. This has not appeared to be the year to request large numbers of computers. Maybe I got that information wrong. If so, I will be back tomorrow morning.
What I was suggesting was that you organize across the three schools a program to sell 150 Macintoshes to parents and get 10 Macintoshes free.
I think that's a great idea, but I also think that there are other schools in the district that also need computers and have relatively speaking, fewer computers in the high school.
Well, maybe you'd only get five of them.
Thursday night, you will hear about that as well, so, I mean, I think Pond Cove has fewer computers in the high school.
Another part of this program is that you can get a Harper will give you an appraisal of your Apple II, you donate that to the school, even if it's being just used for keyboarding skills down at the, you know, in Pond Cove. Somebody can in effect trade in their Apple II and get a Macintosh, and anyway, I'm not, I'm just tossing it out.
Good,
I know you need a Macintosh laboratory.
Yeah, I think we need Macintoshes, and, you know, I only want a laboratory if I need to have a large number of students sit in front of a computer at one time. I would rather have Macintoshes in science laboratories to be used in scientific work there, to be using running models of experiments going on, because in fact that's how computers are more used in science. I think the computer laboratory notion is fine for teaching keyboarding skills, and it needs to be done at some level, and Apple's are probably very adequate for that in terms of teaching keyboarding skills, even though the Apple keyboard is not quite like the typewriter keyboards that most good computers that are used in any kind of more sophisticated setup, but it would certainly teach typing skills very well, and word processing skills at the same time. But the Apple II computer, it would not be my computer of recommendation for either schools or individual families to buy.
No,
I would strongly encourage them to buy Macintosh or IBM clones.
Since I have an Apple II, an Apple III, and a Macintosh,
an eccentric collection of computers.
I do, yes. It's a 10-year collection.
Yes.
You want any of those?
I think in time, Peter, you may take them to Sotheby's, and they may bring you great reward.
I'll put one of
the auction circuit.
Back to Charlie.
Under the Office of Principal, you're preparing us for a 92-93 budget for your 10-year evaluation by New England Association of Schools and Colleges. How big an evaluation team comes?
I think 11 people come. They're here for 3 days. They are here for 9 meals, including a kickoff, that's the wrong word, an opening dinner. We hope it's not kicking off any, but it's an opening dinner, which involves, generally speaking, in most schools, the evaluation team, the school board, the staff, and so on and so forth, and it's sort of an opening dinner. We will have a much more precise budget figure next year. We have already made reservations of rooms at a motel over on Route 1, the name of which escapes me at the moment. I think it's maybe Howard Johnson's. Was that right next to Tony Romo's? I think.
Yeah. I was just looking at $5,000 for 3 days.
I just tried to put that out there.
At that price.
Not in by the
city. Yeah.
I think it's 6 or 7 rooms for 3 nights at $50 or $60 a night, plus meals, plus meeting rooms. They have to have some places to work over there. They have to have secretarial time. And it cannot be school secretaries. That's excluded from the evaluation process. It has to be an outside secretary. Not an employee of the school district, plus word processors, plus so on and so forth.
So it's more involved than just.
It's not just
food and housing.
You got it.
Okay. Back under regular instruction in the high school, why is your, if the amount that's been expended under substitute teachers as of the 26th of February, you still have $11,555, why are you asking for almost $5,000 increase?
Because a number, the current instructional assistant works out of the main office, and we're cutting, does a lot of coverage of classes for subs. And he currently covers fractions of teachers that in another year we might have to hire a full substitute for. And I think I looked at the expenditure of substitutes by the end of the year last year, and out of the money I had last year, I had expended all but about $1,500. So I just assumed if I was cutting that position out, I had to make some estimate. I admit to not necessarily being able at this point to make an exact one, but I think it's a reasonable educated guess.
Would we be using more substitute time next year because of our involvement with the Coalition of Schools?
No, I don't think so, because in fact, we have not used a lot of that grant money this year, but I plan to use some of that grant money for coalition work to cover some of the sub costs. Now, there may be some, but I don't think so particularly. We've also cut back on just this year, just with a budget freeze, on our use of conference and travel funds, so that we have not sent nearly as many people out to be covered by subs as we might in a normal year, just because we tried to, you know, when the budget was frozen in January, we cut that back. So at this point,
and some of that has been cut for next year too. That's correct.
Some, but not. You know, we tend to use, aside from illness, if we use subs for coverage for conferences, those conferences are more likely to happen in October and November, and then again in April, in March and April, and early May, just to eliminate the winter travel vagaries that occur in December, January, February, so that there has been a current lull in terms of that.
The high school was not a great abuser of substitute teacher overs this last year, anyway, meaning the previous year, where there were other schools that were, the other two schools were. Well, and that's been a kind of Achilles heel of mine to watch that this year.
I don't think anybody's abused it.
No.
I think we have not used as much, but I think that, I think in the system we probably have about the right amount of money there. And I think, I may be wrong, but I think if we don't spend all our money on subs and PONCO spends more, you don't do it that way.
I look at a K-8 expenditure in 9-12, that's how the state looks at it.
Okay.
You know, we try to budget what was used for prior years as an indicator.
But when you're making a $6,000 cut here, and then I'm just looking at other areas where I see an increase, and you really haven't even, if we're over half a year,
yeah,
through the school year, and we still have a substantial amount in this particular account, and we're increasing it for next year.
Yeah, but true, but then the flip side of that, if we could have a count of days where that teacher assistant has done the subbing for us, then you'd have an accurate account.
An example of that would be, say on a given day, three teachers are out. We would probably have two subs in that day. Mark Lamont, who was our teacher assistant, would assist, and then we would give those other subs an extra period. And so we would save ourselves, one substitute on a given day. And that works out pretty well. Deb Raymond accounts for those people as they come in. So we do, it is a real helpful one.
Okay, that position cut explains.
Yeah.
And we may come back to you a year from now, and you may be right that we do not need the $24,000 that we've got in there. We may be able to say, in fact, just 2021 or 22, but we just don't know what that will be. We also, I think, are protecting ourselves against the vagaries of the sub market. 2 years ago, we raised our substitute pay. We had to do that to compete. I do not know what other systems will or won't do in terms of paying subs, but we did not raise our pay this year. If we have to do that next year, that would eat that money up at a faster rate as well.
The other issue in sub accounts that is impossible to predict is long-term illness. Mm-hmm. And in a small system with the kinds of sums we're talking about, both K and actually high school, it doesn't take long for long-term illness to just take a huge slice. I mean, one or two people can make a big difference in this, depending on a variety of factors. So, I think it is prudent to leave that money.
Okay. What is this new account, permanent increment / SDA? It's
no,
only $500. It's $3,121.
I would be curious to hear the answer to that, because I didn't
see
put it
that
in there.
You see that in all three departments.
Yes.
What's happened through the contract, the teacher's contract, there is a clause in there that once that teacher has accumulated X amount of credits, he or she qualifies to get a stipend of 100
are up to $200 per year as a permanent increment. Never built in, and it's built in on the computer model also on the recap sheet.
So that's something that's in the current contract?
That's correct. All it is, this actually refers to a line on the, on the MAC that didn't occur before, John.
My last question is under operation and maintenance of plant.
Yeah.
Under a one-town concept, we have split services with the town. We take on some things, they take on another. Now I see we have an upkeep of grounds account for $1,000.
It's probably misclassified. What that is there's a flagpole out there that needs to be refurbished, and that's what it is. It's to a painting of flagpole and exterior lights outside.
And the other account, is contract building repairs is up $10,000. Is this for any kind of, is this just for immediate?
Is that the $30,000?
That's right, it is up $10,000.
Okay, basically that includes all minor electrical, plumbing, carpet repairs, elevator repairs, security alarm service, miscellaneous repairs, hydrant and water inspection, fire extinguishers service, recoat the gym floor, the chlorination of the water in the pool contract. There's a door replacement program. There's to refurbish the art room that we need to look at. Replace the smoke doors in the corridors, as per the fire chief. There's an IA dark room that needs some work. Additional phone in the IA department, repoint the chimney, painting of the interior of the building.
So it's just a lot of little stuff. One of the,
I think my question is this just short-term maintenance, or do we have any kind of five-year maintenance plan of things we're going to be doing?
Well, we do have a five-year maintenance plan, and that's also in contract building repairs, and one of that is painting. And this school, in some cases, still has the original paint in some places, and I have tried to set up with Gary Spencer a painting schedule to paint public spaces and classrooms on a rotating basis, so that we paint classrooms once every 10 years and public spaces, which get more use and abuse, once every 5 years. So there's some of that in that. For example, there's five. It was 7,500. I think it got cut back to five.
It's still 7,500.
I'm just trying to stay ahead. This is a building that fundamentally is in reasonably good repair. I want to keep it that way.
Okay, I think that was my question. Of the three buildings, this is the one in the best repair, which is going to take the least amount of money to keep it up. Where we get into the middle school.
But it's also the biggest building.
Tomorrow night, and that's another.
But, I would look at the paint along the upper edge of the library, and you may see that this, in fact, some of it needs to be repainted.
Okay, I think that's my question. Are we continuing to do some ongoing maintenance in some kind of a five-year plan? Okay. Not just meeting emergency contingencies.
Right. No, I think Gary Spencer has been very good at trying to keep ahead of this. You look out some of the windows in the high school, you can't see out some of them because they're plexiglass, and we're trying to replace glass on a small amount each year just to make sure that some of that plexiglass gets replaced. At one point, I think, 15 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe 5 years ago, they had significant glass breakage. We have thus far not had much in the last couple of years, and we need to replace some of the glass, which just gets discolored. You can't see out the window.
Okay, we have a couple more hours. Do you want to?
There's no breakfast in the budget.
No, I think I'd suggest we break that.
I don't have any questions.
Well, then we will see you all tomorrow night.
Where are we tomorrow night?
In the chambers. And incidentally, before we all get up and leave, how would you like to, in the chambers, on television, and How, do you want to sit on the dais, or do you want to have tables put down below? I would like to sit down below.
That's how it's going to sit.
With the audience's chairs in close, so.
Close quarters, huh?